all for coming on a Saturday to join us. And for those of you who don't know me, my name is Manata Hashemi. I'm the Farzaneh family assistant professor of Iranian studies here at OU. An early happy new year, Iranian New Year, or Norouz, to those of you who celebrate. And we're kickstarting our Norouz festivities a little bit early this year with tonight's lecture, which will be followed by our annual Persian classical music concert at 8 p.m. at Catlett Music Center. And this year's concert will feature the renowned vocalist Ali Reza Shah Mohammadi and the Bamdad Ensemble. So please do join us for that as well. And just to stay abreast of all of our upcoming events and our lectures, please do join our mailing list and follow us on Facebook at Farzaneh Family Center. So tonight, it's my pleasure to introduce to you someone who really doesn't need an introduction, Professor Afshin Marashi, the Farzaneh Family Professor and Chair of Iranian Studies here at OU, and the Director of the Farzaneh Family Center for Iranian and Persian Gulf Studies. And Professor Marashi is a very prolific author whose research on the cultural and intellectual history of nationalism in modern Iran has been featured in numerous prestigious journals, including the International Journal of Middle East Studies, and in the form of several books, including a most recent volume entitled Rethinking Iranian Nationalism and Modernity. And tonight, Professor Marashi will be speaking to us about Cyrus the Great and how modern Iranians came to revive, invent, reconstruct, and contest the memory of Iran's first king. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Professor Afshin Marashi, and please do join us for a reception immediately following the talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Manata. Put this here. Let me just get my notes here. Thank you all for being here today. Khosh amadi. Happy New Year. Happy Persian New Year. I guess like Manata said, it's a little bit early. But we're getting started early enough. This is the classroom I usually teach in, so it's nice to have some students and some community people. I want to thank everyone for being here, and especially all the people who helped to make this event happen. Marjan, Seyed Afipour, Manata Hashemi, of course, Mohammed and Jalal Farzaneh, Alex French, Elena Slater, and Kevin Pope, who's also helps us with these events as well. The Farzaneh Family Center is really a kind of, you know, we've really grown in the last year, and it really is a team effort, so I'm grateful for everyone for their contributions. We are actually, as Manata said, we're trying something a little bit different this year with this event. In addition to the Norouz concert, we thought we'd organize a Norouz lecture. So this is sort of a grand experiment. So I think it's going well so far. We know that sometimes people can't make our lectures and events that are usually held during the week. So we thought we'd try to organize something on a weekend, on a Saturday, especially to coincide with the concert, to maybe make it easier for people who are traveling from a little bit further distances who can't maybe make our normal event. So that's the logic of our event today, to have it a few hours before the concert. I should say we have a number of other events coming up, and here are some flyers. I will put them here, but we can circulate them during the reception. I also want to give a plug to our undergraduate journal, Danesh, which is another one of the really kind of thriving things that the Farzaneh Center has initiated over the last couple of years, and we'll circulate the undergraduate journal as well. We're also starting another new initiative this year, which is to videotape some of our events, and we're going to try to put these on YouTube and to give people who can't always come to our events a chance to see some of these talks. And Manata is leading that effort, but we'll let you know via email when the YouTube page will be set up and active. We will also let you know via Facebook. And Manata mentioned we have a new Facebook page. Please like us on Facebook and go to the Facebook page. There it is. If you just click on Farzaneh Family Center. Let me get my laser pointer. If you just type in Farzaneh Family Center or go at Farzaneh Family Center, that should get you there. We also have an updated website. that we just updated not too long ago. So for more information about all the things we do, please do go to the website as well. And we do have an email list. If you're not on our email list, please talk to either me or Madjon, and we will make sure to put you on our email list. I'm going to talk for about 30 minutes, maybe 40 minutes today, and then we'll have a reception as well. And the subject that I'd like to discuss with you today is a subject that might be suitable for a Norouz lecture. Norouz, of course, represents many things. It's a Persian New Year. It's a time of springtime and renewal. And one of the things that it represents is maybe a chance for Iranians to think about their history, their culture, their heritage, and to perhaps maybe think about how Iranians have come to think of themselves as Iranians. And within that context, one of the cultural symbols of Iranian culture is the figure of Cyrus the Great, the founder of the Achaemenid Persian Empire in the 6th century BC, sometimes called Iran's first king. This is, of course, his tomb. And so what I'd like to reflect on today is the history of the image of Cyrus the Great and how Cyrus has been remembered by Iranians in the context of Iran's modern cultural, intellectual, and political history. And maybe more specifically, I'd like to consider the history of how Iranians have come to imagine Cyrus as a symbol of Iranian national identity, and how Cyrus the Great became a kind of icon, a cultural icon, among Iranians, really in the last century or so. So that's what I'd like to talk to you about. Of course, the tomb of Cyrus is there in Pasargad. This is the Achaemenid Persian Empire. There's Persepolis. Persepolis is the Greek name. Pasargad is the old Persian name, and from there. So that's the context of what we're talking about here. I should add that I'm kind of building on the work of some of my colleagues, like Mohammad Tavakoli, Menachem Nirhevi, Ali Ansari, Monica Ringer, Reza Ebrahimi, Farzin Vejdani, Turaj Daryoyi, and others, who have written on this kind of thing. And so there's a body of scholarship that relates to the issues that I'm talking about. I'm trying to add something to it, hopefully. If we look at the most recent period of Iranian history, say from about 1950, then it's very clear that the image of Cyrus the Great has gained great prominence in Iranian culture. In fact, we can say that the image of Cyrus the Great really came to saturate Iranian culture during this period, especially during the reign of Mohammad Reza Shah. During the 1960s and 70s. Most famously, during the famous speech in October of 1971, marking the 2,500-year anniversary of the founding of the Persian Empire and the Shah's much-publicized speech at the tomb of Cyrus the Great. In fact, if there is sort of one moment that defines the reign of Mohammad Reza Shah, other than his eventual fall, I suppose, then it is this moment, when he declared, standing before the tomb of Cyrus, you know, rest in peace, Cyrus, for we are awake, asude bechav, zirat ma'bidari. I mean, everybody knows this phrase that he uttered at that moment in October 1971. However, if you want to put this speech and the image of Cyrus the Great in a larger historical context, then we have to conclude that the prominence of Cyrus and the attention that Cyrus the Great received in Iran, especially during the 1960s and 1970s, was something very new in Iranian culture. Something, in fact, really almost entirely unprecedented. As I'll try to explain, if we look at the larger context of Iranian cultural history and intellectual history, then we would conclude that Cyrus the Great had never been remembered or revered as a major figure in Iranian historical memory until the middle part of the 20th century. So this is something of a puzzle, and this is something I, in my own kind of investigation of modern 20th century Iranian cultural history and nationalism, it was something that struck me, that it's the image of Cyrus the Great is something that we presume to be very old, but which is in fact something very new. And that puzzle is something I've been trying to unravel, and how that has come about. the story of how this transformation took place, how Cyrus came to be remembered, and how he was written into Iran's national memory, and how he became a national symbol for modern Iranians, has a great deal to do with the making and remaking of national identity in Iran during the 20th century. And that's the story that I'd like to tell. And that's really what I mean by return of the king, sort of the returning after being forgotten, you might say, for a very long time. So I'd like to divide this talk into three parts. First, say something about, you know, what are the written sources about Cyrus the Great in the pre-modern period? Second, I'll say something about how Iranian intellectuals during the 19th and 20th century came to remember Cyrus and learn about him. And finally, I'd like to say something about the use of Cyrus the Great as a symbol during the 20th century, especially during the reign of the Shah and to some extent following the revolution. So let's start with part one, the pre-modern conceptions of Cyrus the Great. Until the latter part of the 19th century, there was very little reference to Cyrus the Great in the Persian language. We can detail this by looking at the historical sources. And there are really five major sources that tell the story of Cyrus the Great. First is the Greek sources. The main historical sources that detail the life and achievements of Cyrus the Great are sources that were written in the Greek language. The writings of the Greek historians, Herodotus and Xenophon. But significantly, these were sources that were actually not available in the Persian language or in Arabic in the classical or medieval periods. While the writings of Herodotus and Xenophon were available in Greek, these texts were never translated into Persian or Arabic prior to the modern period. The Greek historical sources remained in Greek, which was unusual because, you know, if we know anything about classical, medieval, Middle Eastern Islamic history, part of that history is the story of translation of Greek sources into Arabic and knowledge of those sources among Persian readers and into Persian as well. But history seems to have been at least a partial exception. Most of the Greek sources from philosophy and science were translated into Arabic and into Persian in some respects, but not Greek historical writings. So knowledge of Cyrus must have come later and through other sources. Let me say something about the Shahnameh. We will not find mention of Cyrus the Great in the Shahnameh. There is no explicit mention of him in the Shahnameh. The Shahnameh, of course, is a 10th century epic poem that narrates the pre-Islamic history of Iran from a kind of mythic creation myth right down to the Arab Muslim conquest of the 7th century. It is probably by far the most important traditional source for understanding the historical awareness of Iranians regarding their history, especially their pre-Islamic history. Certainly at the popular level, the Shahnameh would be memorized and performed publicly, performance of the Shahnameh, the tradition of Naqali, something like minstrels and troubadours would sort of roam the countryside putting on performances and narrations and oral recitations of the Shahnameh. The narrative structure of the Shahnameh includes a chronology of both mythological and historical dynasties. You know, the Pishtadian kings, the Kianid, Ashkanid, Sasanid dynasties, those are all present in the Shahnameh. The Shahnameh also has a poetic telling of the story of Alexander the Great's conquest of Iran. As well as a poetic narration of the fall of the Sasanian Empire at the time of the Arab Muslim conquest, both of which are actually real historic events that the Shahnameh in fact includes. Significantly, however, there is no mention of Cyrus the Great in the Shahnameh, or any mention of the Achaemenid dynasty, which is of course the dynasty that he founded. The author of the Shahnameh, Ferdowsi, seems to have been unaware of the Achaemenid dynasty and the figure of Cyrus the Great. So again, knowledge of Cyrus the Great must have come later and through other sources. Let me say something about the Quran. There is no mention of Cyrus the Great in the Quran. Although the Quran does itself have numerous references to biblical figures and historical figures, Adam, Abraham, Moses, of course Jesus is in the story of Jesus is in the Quran. The Quran also makes reference to other historical figures, including references to a figure that is usually considered to be Alexander the Great, Zur or name. It's a, sort of the name of this character in the Quran, which is some somewhat mysterious historical figure, described in the Surah of the Cave, and is described in general terms as a figure who ruled a vast empire and who ruled with great justice. And in most of the pre-modern historiographic tradition of Islam, this figure was always considered to be Alexander the Great. But some later 20th century historians or scholars of the Quran, including the great Iranian scholar Said Nafisi, argued that, in fact, this figure in the Quran is, in fact, Cyrus the Great. But this is a somewhat controversial story. And certainly in the pre-20th century, nobody thought that this figure would have been Cyrus the Great. Everybody assumed it was Alexander the Great. And it's so vaguely worded that it's difficult to say. So again, knowledge of Cyrus the Great must have come later and through other sources. Let me say something about the Bible. The Hebrew Bible does mention the Cyrus the Great. And so in addition to the Greek sources, the Greek histories, it's really the Bible that is the main historical document where our knowledge of Cyrus the Great comes from. The story of Cyrus, the figure who conquered Babylon, who freed the Jews, who made the human rights decree in the form of the famous Cyrus cylinder, which I'll say something a little bit more about as well. The figure who assisted the Jews to return to Palestine, to rebuild the Temple of Solomon, that's Cyrus. That narrative of Cyrus the Great is part of the religious history of Judaism. And it comes to us from the Hebrew Bible, primarily in the book of Daniel and the book of Ezra of the Old Testament. And what is interesting and somewhat surprising, and this is something I haven't quite figured out yet, is that despite this record of Cyrus the Great in the biblical sources, this biblical account of Cyrus doesn't seem to have left much of an impression on a broader historical, Iranian historical consciousness of Cyrus. It's surprising because, of course, there's a large Jewish community in Iran who were, of course, familiar with the Hebrew sources. And yet it seems that the Jewish historiographic tradition didn't really make much of an impression on the pre-modern Iranian historical awareness of Cyrus the Great. And it would seem that the most important defining sources for pre-modern Iranians was the Shahnameh and the Quran. And those were the sources that defined their historical awareness. Let me say something about Islamic historiography, not the Quran itself, but the tradition of historical writing in Arabic by Muslim historians. And there is another large body of historical writing in Arabic and Persian produced by medieval Muslim historians, most significantly the historians Tabari and Belami and many others. These historians produced universal histories that narrated the history of the world from creation all the way down to the time of Muhammad and the early Muslim community. In the pre-Islamic portions of these universal histories, such as the great history of Tabari, we do find mention of Cyrus. Tabari, for example, very clearly mentions Cyrus as the conqueror of Babylon and the liberator of the Jews. But in Tabari, the mention of Cyrus is very brief. And the narration of Tabari doesn't have the kind of grand or epic quality that we might expect, given how important Cyrus was in Jewish history and how important he became in 20th century Iranian memory. The mention of Cyrus in Tabari is really a kind of passing reference. Tabari, in fact, seems confused about Cyrus, and some of the details on the chronology that he presents doesn't actually match up with the biblical or Greek history. So it's actually unclear what sources Tabari is drawing from to some extent. Anyway, this is a somewhat brief survey, but all of this is to suggest that there was very little, if any, awareness of Cyrus the Great in Iranian historical consciousness in the pre-modern period. This began to change dramatically in the 19th and 20th centuries. And it changed for a number of reasons, and that's what I want to describe for you now. First, we can say it was access to new historical writings produced in the European languages by Iranian intellectuals. Iranians became aware of Cyrus the Great through contact with European historical writing, especially beginning in the 19th century, primarily via the French and English languages, but also German and Russian as well. The history of the ancient Near East, including Iran's ancient history, was a major preoccupation for European historians and archaeologists during that time. And the histories of ancient Iran, written by European historians, left a very important and profound impression on Iranian intellectuals who were increasingly learning European languages and reading these new histories of the ancient past. And among the most famous is John Malcolm, who wrote a two-volume work of the history of Persia, you can see in 1815, which was probably the first grand English language narrative of Iran's entire history from the beginning down to the present. The Greek historians also were now more available in the 19th century to Iranians because Herodotus and Xenophon were translated into English and French as well, and Iranians were now learning English and French. By the middle of the 19th century, these texts began to circulate widely, and Iranians began to read them, as well as the story in the Old Testament as well. Here's another example. You know, the ancient history in 19th century European writing, it became very popular. It was a very popular genre. This is a student textbook on ancient history written in the 19th century. It left a very large impression among anyone who had access to knowledge in the 19th century in European languages. Let me say something about archaeology and the role that archaeology played, which was also very important. The decipherment of ancient languages, like Henry Rawlinson's decipherment of the Behistun inscription relating to Darius the Great in 1838, revived an understanding of the Achaemenid Empire and an understanding of Cyrus the Great. There's the inscription in the side of a mountain. Here's an actual photo of it. You can see it was in the script that was deciphered by Henry Rawlinson, and this was actually a very important new piece of source material about the Achaemenid Empire that was unknown by this period. Similarly, the Cyrus cylinder, which was discovered in 1879 by this gentleman that you see here, a Chaldean British archaeologist. I mean, today we would maybe call him an Iraqi Christian, but he was from the Chaldean community of Mesopotamia. He eventually became a British subject, Hormozd Rassam, who was the person who discovered the Cyrus cylinder in 1879. And the discovery of this cylinder received a great deal of international attention in the 19th century, and likewise revived interest in the history of Iran's ancient king among European archaeologists and historians, as well as Iranians. Let me say something about, and you can see, this is actually when you begin to see Iranians posing in front of these archaeological sites. This is actually an interesting photo because it shows the tomb of Cyrus probably in the, I don't know, 1870s or 1880s. You can see there was weeds growing out of it. But it started to be photographed, and Iranians themselves began to see it in a new light and began to make pilgrimages of sorts to have their pictures taken around these kinds of archaeological sites. Let me say something about new historical writing. The result of all of these influences is that there is a very clear revival of pre-Islamic Iranian history among Iranian intellectuals by the end of the 19th century. All of the major Iranian nationalist intellectuals of this time, people like Mirza Fatali Akhundzadeh, Jalaluddin Mirza, Mirza Agha Khan Kermani, and many others, began to write, to narrate, to tell stories, all of which revived the memory of Iran's ancient history. Their writing had a shared feature of describing pre-Islamic Iran as a kind of golden age, a period in Iranian history before the coming of Islam, which was described as an era of enlightenment, progress, political power, prosperity, of Iranian greatness. It was a kind of utopian view, a very romanticized view. And it became part of the fabric of Iranian cultural, intellectual life from that time, in some ways, right down to the present. And the image of Cyrus the Great fit very well into this 19th century reappraisal of Iran's pre-Islamic history. Cyrus became the symbol of the ideal king, the perfect king who ruled with justice, who made Iran a great power in the ancient world, and brought prosperity to the kingdom. He made Iran great again, if I can use that. This became the image of Cyrus the Great from the late 19th century onward. Of the three intellectuals that I mentioned, it is only Kermani who mentions Cyrus the Great specifically. Mirza Agha Khan Kermani is himself a sort of a fascinating figure in this story. He was a free-thinking, largely self-taught intellectual of Babi background. He spent his most intellectually productive years in the 1880s and the 1890s living in Istanbul, where he would read and write. And he is arguably one of the Iranians most responsible for producing this utopian understanding of pre-Islamic Iran. He wrote a number of books, including the Aineh Iskandari. And it's in this book, written in the 1890s, excuse me, that Kermani narrates a new history of ancient Iran. And it's a book that synthesizes European historical writing about ancient Iranian history with traditional Iranian narratives of ancient Iran. It's in this book that Kermani tells the story of Cyrus the Great, probably for the first time in the Persian language, for an audience of Iranian readers. He explicitly makes reference to the biblical and Greek historical sources, as well as to 19th century European historical writing about ancient Iran. Significantly, Kermani makes the argument that Cyrus the Great was in fact not a forgotten figure in Iranian history, because he argues that the Kayanid king Kehosro from Ferdowsi's Shahnameh is in fact Cyrus the Great. Kermani uses some very complicated reasoning to draw this conclusion, but his goal was to try to harmonize the mythical narrative of Iran's pre-Islamic history, as found in the Shahnameh, with new historical knowledge from European sources. He's actually not the only person to do this. In fact, John Malcolm also postulated that maybe this king, Kehosro, was actually Cyrus the Great. And that might have been where Kermani got the idea. The next time that we see historical work written in Persian that invoke Cyrus the Great is in the early 20th century. And the figure of Mirzadeh Eshqi, one of the most significant early 20th century modernist poets, also mentioned Cyrus the Great in his poetry. He wrote, he famously wrote a one-act play sometime around 1915 called the Rastakhiz Padishahan Iran, the Resurrection of Iran's Kings. And it's a story that invokes the greatness of Iran's ancient kings, and significantly, the kings that Eshqi includes are the mythical kings of Ferdowsi's Shahnameh, but also he includes specific reference to Cyrus the Great. The next stage is in the 1920s. By the 1920s, we see the emergence of historical novels for the first time in the history of Persian literature. This is actually a new genre of writing, historical novels. Literacy rates were growing during this time, and Iranians were choosing what they wanted to read, and apparently they had a great interest in fiction, historical fiction. And it's interesting that among the very first historical novels that emerged during this period were historical fictional accounts that told the life of Cyrus the Great. The earliest and maybe the most important was written in 1920, a novel called Eshq ve Saltanat, or Love and Monarchy. This might actually be the very first historical novel written in modern Persian literature by a guy named Musa Nasri Hamadani. And it tells the story, a fictional account of Cyrus the Great in a kind of literary form. So Cyrus the Great was now entering into a kind of literature, into the history of Persian literature. The 1920s and the 1930s also produced what is probably the most important historical work about pre-Islamic Iran ever written by an Iranian author in the Persian language. And I'm referring to this gentleman, Hassan Pirnia, who wrote a three-volume book, Iran of Bastan, Ancient Iran. The work was the first historical text about pre-Islamic Iran that sets aside the mythic history of Ferdowsi and instead begins the narrative of ancient Iran with the history of the Achaemenid Empire, a historical dynasty that was never mentioned in the Shahnameh. In Hassan Pirnia's history, instead of Kiumars as sort of the primordial atom of creation, Cyrus the Great is the beginning of Iranian history and is defined as the founder of the Iranian nation. Pirnia devotes about 250 pages to the life and deeds of Cyrus the Great, drawing extensively from the work of the Greek historians, Herodotus, as well as European sources, as well as from biblical accounts. So in a very real way, it is with the writing of Hassan Pirnia and this book, Iran of Bastan, that the image of Cyrus as we understand it today is really born within modern Iranian cultural history. Now, let me say something about the reign of Muhammad Reza Shah Pahlavi and the role of Cyrus the Great during his reign. Despite the importance of Cyrus the Great in the work of Hassan Pirnia, Cyrus the Great still remained a marginal figure, a figure that only intellectuals would know about. Despite his importance, it would take a little bit longer for Cyrus to emerge as a true icon, if you will. And that would be in the 1960s and 1970s. He sort of entered into the pop culture of Iran during this period. In a very real way, it is only during this period, 1960s and 1970s, that Cyrus the Great became a public symbol in Iran and became an image that was promoted by the Iranian state. And you see this on postcards, on currency, on postage stamps, and whatnot. This is a famous, another famous novel by a figure, Harold Lamb. Harold Lamb was a popular historical writer, an American, who was also a screenwriter who worked on many of those biblical epics from the early 1960s, you know, the Cecil B. DeMille biblical epics. I think he wanted to make a movie about Cyrus the Great, although it was never made, so we can still wait for the Cyrus the Great Cecil B. DeMille version. but that's the kind of pop culture that Cyrus the Great was, and Harold Lamb's books were translated into Persian as well during this period. This is a coin, I don't know if you can see this, this is a Pahlavi coin, of course, with the Cyrus cylinder on one side, and then there's the Shah, and that's Cyrus the Great on the other side, standing next to the Shah. This is a children's book from 1970. As part of a series of these sort of popular children's story books that tells the story of Cyrus the Great. This is Shajaluddin Shafa, who was probably the most important person responsible for popularizing the image of Cyrus the Great during this period. If there was a kind of court historian of the Pahlavi monarchy in the 60s and 70s, it was Mr. Shafa. Who wrote many popular books, I think he was television, radio. He was also a major figure who helped to plan the 2,500-year anniversary ceremony of 1971, and you can see he just died several years ago. So why is this? You know, what were the reasons that help to explain why Cyrus the Great emerges during this period in the 60s and 70s as a popular icon in this way, in the context of the reign of Mohammad Reza Shah? And I would suggest a number of things. First, after the Mossadegh episode of 1953, Mohammad Reza Shah felt that the legitimacy of his rule had been compromised as a result of the CIA-sponsored coup. The Shah's response to this was to greatly increase his own visibility and to have to help attempt to elevate his own stature within Iranian culture and to maybe compensate or overcompensate for a perceived crisis of legitimacy. So it's from this period that we see this growing link between the ideas of nation and monarchy, where loyalty to the nation came to mean loyalty to the monarchy itself. And so that I think is part of the reason. Another reason for promoting the image of Cyrus the Great was to remind Iranians and the world of Iran's progressive policies towards the minority communities inside Iran, especially towards Iran's Jewish community. The message was that just as Cyrus freed the Jews from Babylon, so too the Shah was also following an enlightened policy towards religious and ethnic minority communities inside Iran. Related to this was the growing thorny issue of human rights. There was growing criticism of the Shah's human rights record during the 1960s and 70s, and associating the Shah with Cyrus the Great and defining the Cyrus cylinder as the world's first charter of human rights was a way of deflecting from the criticisms of the Shah's human rights record in the 60s and 70s. The Shah was essentially saying, don't criticize me about human rights. Cyrus the Great invented human rights, and I'm the heir of Cyrus the Great. Finally, the image of Cyrus the Great during the 60s and 70s is also related to Iran's foreign policy during that time, and especially the implications of the Shah's invocation of Cyrus the Great for Iran's policy towards neighboring Iraq. Of course, Cyrus the Great not only freed the Jews, but he also conquered Babylon, which was the territorial precursor to modern-day Iraq, of course. And during the 1960s and 70s, there was growing tension between Iran and Iraq, which, of course, we know led to war in the 1980s. The Shah's military buildup during the 60s and 70s, which he was greatly criticized for at the time, was in part designed to prepare for a possible war with Iraq. And so the Shah's invocation of the image of Cyrus the Great also had foreign policy implications with respect to demonstrating Iran's power and resolve against the growing threat posed by this highly militarized Soviet-allied Ba'athist state in neighboring Iraq. In a sense, the Shah was saying, just as Cyrus conquered Babylon, so too I might conquer Iraq, if I'm threatened that way. So in retrospect, you know, we can sort of understand the symbolism of Cyrus the Great in the context of the Shah's military buildup during those decades. And so there's a foreign policy element to the Cyrus the Great issue as well. Now, I'm just going to add just a little bit more here, and then we can, if you have questions and discussion, and then we can go to have our pastries and have reception as well. But the revival of the image of Cyrus the Great was something very recent in Iranian history, as I've tried to suggest. It had a great deal to do with the politics of Iran during the mid-20th century. Culture, history, symbolism, politics were all very much interconnected with a particular understanding of Cyrus the Great. The symbol was ultimately closely associated with the politics of the Pahlavi dynasty during the 60s and 70s. Let me say something about since the revolution. Since 1979, the leadership of the Islamic Republic has been ambivalent towards invoking the culture of Iran's pre-Islamic past. The ideology of the revolution was in large part a repudiation of the culture of the Pahlavi monarchy, and the symbol of Cyrus was a kind of reminder of the Shah. Nevertheless, since the 1990s, leaders of the Islamic Republic have made their own visits to the sites around Persepolis. Hashemi Rafsanjani in 1991 made a visit. Mohammad Khatami in 2001. Hassan Rouhani, you see him here, in 2015 made a visit. The Supreme Leader Khamenei has actually said some interesting things as well about the pre-Islamic period and Persepolis and the archaeology. Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, most interestingly, in 2011, personally posed next to the Cyrus cylinder when it was brought to Iran on loan. It's permanently housed at the British Museum in London. So if you're ever in London, definitely go to the British Museum. You can see it. But it came to Iran in 2011, and Ahmadinejad made a point to go and visit and get his picture taken. During the 2009 Green Movement, and since, the symbols associated with pre-Islamic Iran have actually been used to express opposition to the clerical regime. Most recently, in October, just this past October, which is what you see here, there was a large-scale gathering at the tomb of Cyrus the Great on the unofficial Cyrus the Great Day in Iran, and the gathering turned into a political protest. And we should also say that Cyrus the Great and the Cyrus cylinder is also a very powerful symbol among the Iranian diaspora community. Iranians living outside of Iran, and that's sort of what you see here. You know, the Cyrus cylinder and the memory of Cyrus the Great not only has a kind of nostalgic quality for kind of remembering pre-revolutionary Iran, so it plays into that kind of cultural memory as well. So all of these things are going on simultaneously. In any case, what is clear is that Cyrus the Great and the Cyrus cylinder has become not only an object, but a symbol. A symbol that continues to be infused with politics and has multiple, varied, contradictory meanings. And like all symbols, the symbol of Cyrus the Great and the Cyrus cylinder ultimately says more about us, I would say, and how we choose to remember the past than it says about Cyrus or the cylinder itself. So Cyrus the Great remains a highly controversial, politicized symbol, but a symbol that is perhaps used and is being used in still new ways that we're only perhaps beginning to understand. And how the Cyrus cylinder will fit into the evolving cultural politics inside Iran or within the context of U.S.-Iranian relations, and how the cylinder will continue to be defined and redefined today and in the future, that I think is a very open question. But it's a question that I think all of us will and should participate in trying to answer. Thank you very much. I think I'll stop.